Life's too short to drive boring cars.
Hyundai and Kia are becoming a very, very popular brand, and they'd love to show you and tell you all about it. But unfortunately, one thing they don't necessarily want to tell you about are all the engine issues that have plagued the brands over the last bunch of years. I want to share that with you so you can go out there armed with the information to make some great choices and don't land yourself with a vehicle full of heartache and heartbreak. Let's get into it now. Now, to go back a few years and track the history of the Hyundai brand, we talk about the Pony. Back in the mid-80s, there was a little car called the Hyundai Pony, which was very popular in Canada, sold by the droves. It was only listed at about $5,900 starting, and as a matter of fact, it was the price of a small, cheap entry-level quad or skidoo. So as you can imagine, many, many people decided it was a great idea to buy. And at $5,900, many people considered it a great purchase. But unfortunately, the flip side was many did assume it was a throwaway car. And throwaway, in fact, it was. I had friends in the industry that often referred to the Hyundai Pony as using lead piston rings. Well, that wasn't entirely true. It was a little comical. That's because they were burning oil at very low miles. They generally didn't hold up very well. The engines were weak. And at about 70 horsepower, not only was the output very low, but the lifespan was very poor in these vehicles too. They really were throwaway. And many markets saw the writing on the wall. For example, the US didn't even want that on the market. It was essentially Canada that adopted that car. And then in 1985, along came the Hyundai Excel, which was equally a disaster. That ran the gamut up to about 1999, featuring largely a 1.5 liter four banger, or you can get a 1.3 in certain markets. And that car had a host of issues. Again, very, very cheap and affordable to buy, and that was the attraction. But unfortunately, the car was a mess. For example, problems. You had coolant leaks coming out of the dash, thermostat issues that would prevent the car from heating up, automatic transmissions that would essentially stall out the car when you pump it into reverse, or the manual gearbox often had shifting related issues. The ECM, yes, lots of problems with the control modules, where sometimes the poor grounds would result in poor running conditions. Engines, absolutely horrifying. Not a great engine design by any stretch of the imagination, and they wouldn't last the test of time. The Excel had a recall for the reeds separating from the reed valve assembly, or the valve wouldn't function properly at all, leading to hot exhaust gases flowing back up into the plastic secondary air filter case while the vehicle is being driven. These hot gases then cause that plastic to melt and potentially leading to an engine fire. And then, have you heard about the oil burning consumption issues with the Hyundai Sonata? Sure, while there's a simple fix, the problem is it's all in the details. And yet there was another one, a 2016 Hyundai Tucson oil consumption issue actually went to a class action lawsuit. And sadly, while many customers report that their engines are consuming a quart in 1,000 or 500 miles is absolutely absurd, regardless of what a lot of the manufacturers are saying and signing off on, the point of the matter is it's using way too much oil. And so a lot of these cars, in fact, are doing that. But we're not going to talk about the old school 80s and 90s cars. Let's talk about cars of today. A lot of you guys have probably heard some of the big issues with engine fires in today's Hyundais and Kias. Now, the reality is there's many, many Hyundais and Kias that have had fires or engine-related fire retype or recalls. If you scour down this list, you'll find hundreds of thousands, and if not millions, of vehicles with identified either fire risks or engine-related failure type risks. And as many as 7.2 million Hyundai and or Kia vehicles are subject to potential fire or engine-related failures and recalls. And while some of those numbers are realistically only in that 1-5% of affected vehicles, the point of the matter is there's a huge volume of engines subject to potential catastrophic failure. Now, while there's a variety of different reasons why some of these failures are happening, some of them could be as simple as a hydraulic electronic control unit that may suffer a short circuit and result in a fire, or a tight wiring harness that gets stretched across too tightly under acceleration. It sometimes can pull and tug at the wiring harness, resulting in an open circuit or a fire hazard. Now, the big one which Hyundai and Kia allegedly were a little slow to respond to were the big ones. And it's the ones that have put a lot of people out. It's a lot of ones that have created roadside fires and resulting in vehicles burning to the ground. As a matter of fact, it was so bad, in fact, a year or so ago, Hyundai and Kia recommended to owners that they park their vehicles outside of the garage for fear that they might sustain an engine failure. But some of the big failures are a result of during the crankshaft machining process in the factory. Often there was cases of some of the burrs and the metallics getting away and falling down into the crankshaft oil cooling passages. And unfortunately, those passages are there for a reason. They're there ultimately to create cooling and lubrication to the crankshaft journals and the rod bearings themselves. If you don't get enough oiling in there, it can result in overheating and ultimately in a seizure and or potentially catastrophic engine failure. And sadly, there's been many, many cases across the board. It's hit the news like wildfire of people finding themselves roadside with their car burning to the ground, resulting in nothing but a molten pile of metal and plastic stacked on top of a set of rubber tires and rims. Now, while apparently the recall identifies about 1.7 million vehicles with this particular issue, Hyundai and Kia are saying that they're estimating only about 2% are afflicted. Either way, you're still talking about 30,000 vehicles, roughly thereabouts. Do you want to be in that number? And which engines are they specifically? Well, we're talking about the 2-liter and the 2.4 liter gas direct injected engines. From a variety of years, from 2009 to 2012, then all of a sudden 2013 and 14 model years were afflicted. While most of these were the Theta 2 engines, there was also NU engines, and now there's engines reported up to 2016 with the 1.6 liter in the Velostar and other vehicles, for example, that are equally afflicted. So what are the warning signs and what are the dealers going to do about it for you? Well, first of all, the warning signs, number one, is there an audible knocking noise? So obviously when you have a rod knock or a problem with the rod bearings at the bottom, you hear this weird noise or a knocking noise at the bottom of the engine that maybe you didn't notice before, that could be a sign. If it gets far enough, you could get the engine light illuminating. And ultimately, the worst case scenario is an engine shutting off completely, becoming a serious hazard, particularly if you're driving down the freeway and the car decides to shut off or lock up or seize up altogether. So what are the dealers saying they're going to do for a fix? Well, they're saying that they're going to either install software or knock sensing hardware to detect the sounds of the knocking prematurely. To me, personally, in my opinion, that's just a band-aid, because if you're waiting for that time to happen, ultimately it's almost too late. And all you're doing is putting a band-aid on the ultimate issue. This is not a fix. This is just a band-aid, in my opinion. So I bet you're probably wondering if the vehicle you own today or one that you're potentially looking for has that problem. Well, guess what? I'm going to share a few right now. The 2012 to 13 Kia Sorento with the 2.4 liter Theta 2 multi-port injection engine. The 2012 Kia Sportage SUV with the 2.4. Then the 2012 to 2015 Kia Forte and the Coupe, either equipped with the 2.0 NU engine or the 2.4 liter Theta 2 engine. How about a 2011 to 13 Kia Optima? Hyundai Santa Fe with the 2.4. 2015 to 16 Hyundai Veloster with the 1.6 liter Gamma gasoline direct injected engine, or the 2011 to 2013 Hyundai Sonata Hybrid that uses the 2.4 liter Theta 2 engine, and the Sonata Hybrid with the 2.0. Now again, what the dealers are going to do is install that knock sensing equipment, they'll do an inspection on the engine, and they're going to provide a 15 year 150,000 mile warranty on these vehicles, specifically for the engine block assembly. Now, I'm sure that all sounds very delicious and delightful, but it's, again, it's not only about the warranty, it's all about the inconvenience. And if you lose your car for a month or 2 months because it's getting a new engine, that's a serious inconvenience. They're not talking about other costs that you might incur for a rental car or taking the bus or a cab to work if you're waiting for that car to be repaired. Now, don't take just my word for it. Have you heard about the recent update about the whistleblower that was actually paid about $24 million by the US government's road safety, who stepped up and provided details and proof that Kia and Hyundai took way too long to address these potential pitfalls? So on top of that, Hyundai and Kia had to dish out about $137 million in fines for safety improvements in an agreement to fix these engine problems. The announcement came as a follow-up to a 3-year investigation to the company's behavior regarding these recalls of all these different models since 2011. Hyundai also had to pay out $54 million in civil penalties and had to reinvest $40 million just to upgrade some of their facilities. Kia, on the other hand, which is an affiliation of Hyundai, had to pay out $27 million in penalties and about $16 million in safety performance upgrades. So as many people as have been negatively afflicted by some of these issues, there's been many, many millions of people that have loved this brand and they swear by it through and through. Hyundai and Kia have created some great new models like the Ioniq 5, Santa Cruz Veloster, the Kona, Santa Fe Tucson, the Kia Soul, Stinger, Niro Optima, and the new and extremely popular Telluride that seems to be hard to get these days. But I just have to bring it to light. Unfortunately, there's been some troublesome times for Kia and Hyundai, and I'm hoping they're over that hill and that hump, because I look forward to another great brand with some new breakthrough technologies and some competitive vehicles to keep all the big players on their toes. And with all of that said, be sure to click right there. There's a handful of vehicles that won't make it 5 years. Hope to see you real soon. Catch you next time. Bye-bye. Shoo.